You would think after doing this for a number of years, I would remember to unmute myself before I introduce everybody, but evidently not. Senior moments, let's call it. Anyway, Red May, we are continuing onward into our second week of our fifth year. It's pretty amazing. Of course, we are honored to have Michael Heinrich, one of the leading lights of the Neue Marx Lektüre, if I've got my German somewhat correct, who will give a talk on the political impact of Marx's form analysis. So before that, I just want to say, go to our website, www.redmayseattle.org, and you can find our schedule. We have 33 more events left. And I leave you to discover them yourselves. You will also discover on that website a donate button. Because as you may imagine, there is no institutional funding for a festival whose mottos is be a commie for a month or take a vacation from capitalism. So we depend on your generosity. We have a Patreon on our website. There's a GoFundMe, or you can go directly to fan the flames of Red May. But now I want to get into the main event today and introduce Michael Heinrich, since I haven't memorized Michael's institutional affiliation. I will tell a more winding and serpentine story. First I heard a rumor of Michael Heinrich many years ago, and the first thing I found was a mimeographed copy posted online of something called Invaders from Marx, which intrigued me. And then many people in this audience continue to provide more information, both on the Value Form Facebook group and in Viewpoint magazine, where there was an article on the New Marxisms many years ago. And there was a time when, in order to read Michael, I had to buy the first book from the Casa del Libro in Barcelona, and I read the introduction of three volumes of Marx in Spanish, because there was nothing in English. But now we have two books out, the first volume of his biography, three-volume biography of Marx, and the introduction of three volumes, and we have two books coming out imminently. I think in June or July from Monthly Review Press, we have How to Read Capital, which is a commentary on the first three chapters of Capital. I've seen bits of it. It's absolutely mesmerizing, and you can read it in small chunks because it's a commentary like commentaries to Homer or to Herodotus. And the much-awaited Science of Value is going to come out first at Brill and then in Haymarket Press. So we have a lot of Michael to get through, but now we have the privilege here at Red May of hearing Michael in person. Michael, welcome to Red May and welcome to sort of invisible Seattle, as it were.
Yeah, thank you very much for the invitation. I'm very happy to speak here and to talk with you. But first, I want to do a small, not correction, but a thing to be a little bit cautious. You introduced me as a representative of Neue Marx Lektüre, and this is very usual, it became usual, but I think we should be a little bit cautious with such labels. Such labels can give a first orientation, what is the background of a person, but we shouldn't not exaggerate this. For example, Hans-Georg Backhaus, who also is seen as a representative of Neue Marx Lektüre, from whom I learned a lot, but nevertheless, we have also a lot of differences. And so I want to stress there is not a kind of common position finding. And insofar, I announced my talk today not as the political impact of Neue Marx-Lektüre, but I announced it as political impact of Marx form analysis. Some others who are counted to Neue Marx-Lektüre, perhaps they will agree, others will not agree, but this is not for me the point now. So when I talk about Marx form analysis, it is already said by this title, I stress the form aspects in Marx analysis, like value form and what rests on this, especially the analysis of the different kinds of fetishism and mystifications which emerge in the capitalist mode of production. In the first 100 years of capital reception after 1867, form and fetishism played nearly no role in the discussion about capital. When value theory was discussed, it was always the discussion which kind of value theory, a utility theory of value or a labor theory of value, what had to do with the fact that after Marx Capital appeared, the so-called marginalist revolution started and was rather successful in bourgeois economics. And insofar, this issue of form and fetishism for a long time played not an important role, or maybe not even a role. In the last approximately five decades, the situation changed. Form and fetishism became an issue. Discussions about this increased. However, very often a critique was formulated that these discussions about form and fetishism is a kind of pure philology without any political use. Some persons produced a picture that there is one part of the leftists using Marx Capital as a political weapon trying to attack capitalism. And another part of leftists is researching some details in the developing of Marx thought, comparing different manuscripts of Marx, but without any political impact. Very simplified, a practical left without philology on the one hand, and an academic left doing philology without political practice. As usual, reality is a little bit more complicated like this. And I want now to stress I want to correct this picture somehow. And I want to stress that Marx's analysis of form and fetishism, which indeed needs some precise reading, some philology for understanding, that this analysis indeed has an political impact, and that this impact is important to overcome some weak points of the traditional left or of traditional left position, which often believes things are so easy and clear that precise reading of Capital or manuscripts before Capital is an exaggeration, a waste of time for persons who want to do politics. So my first point, very short, I want to talk a little bit about what means form analysis. I can give only some sketches, otherwise the time would be too short. And then I will come to political impacts, especially talking about class, about the very often discussed question about revolutionary subject, and briefly about state and Marx's notion of socialism or communism. But first, the question, what means form analysis? The notion of form is, I think, enormously important for the things Marx is doing in Capital. Already in the preface of volume one, he speaks of the analysis of economic forms where no microscope can help, only abstraction. Many readers oversee this, don't see this, but I think it has a meaning that Marx didn't speak of economic objects, but of the analysis of economic forms. And this stressing of economic forms also repeats in the first paragraph of the first chapter of Capital, where Marx, after his famous sentence that the wealth in societies where capitalist mode of production is prevailing appears as a collection of commodities, he continues that the individual commodity is the elementary form of wealth. Again, he doesn't speak of an elementary unit, he speaks of an elementary form. And also in the following, you will find when you read with attention that Marx distinguished several times content and form. Use values are the material content of wealth, no matter what is its social form, is said on the next page. And from the first paragraph, we know the form of wealth in capitalist societies is the commodity form. But what constitutes the form aspect of the commodity? It is the value of the commodity. This is not a natural form aspect, it is a social and historical aspect, and it exists only under certain social conditions. And it is revealed that value rests on labor. Many readings of Capital's first chapter stop more or less at this point, stressing labor is the substance of value. Value is not a natural thing. Value is the result of spending labor. However, three further moments must be regarded here very briefly. I don't want to repeat a reading of Capital. First moment, value is not just the result of labor, it is the result of abstract labor. I suppose you all know this notion, concrete labor produces use value, abstract labor is represented in the value of commodities. However, it is important that abstract labor is not a kind of natural attribute of any labor. Marx stresses that it is only an attribute of labor represented in commodities. In the Penguin edition, unfortunately, this is translated as embodied in commodity, but the more precise translation would be represented in commodities. Considering the capitalist production, we have use values which shall become commodities, but they are not already commodities in production. Also, this is stressed by Marx when he writes in the reworking manuscript of the first edition and then in the French edition of Capital, that the reduction of concrete labor to abstract labor only happens in the exchange process. In the production process, we cannot speak about abstract labor, and in so far, we can also not speak about commodity or value in the production process. So, in order to become commodity, in order to become value and an object of value, a social process beyond production is necessary. The second moment I want to mention, value is not a thing, but a social fact. I think we agree all on this, but it has consequences. You cannot touch or feel it, like a use value. Value objectivity needs an objective expression, a value form. And this is the importance of this value form analysis in chapter one, which is the biggest part of chapter one, but unfortunately very often not recognized. The result of this analysis is that the money form is the only adequate form of value. This leads, when you develop these thoughts, to a monetary theory of value, which is basically different as well from the value theory of classical political economy, as well of value theories of modern political economy, let us say, marginalism or neoclassical theory. But I don't want to go here more in detail about monetary theory of value. I just want to give this hint here. The third moment we have to regard talking about value is that value as a social fact, it is a social relation expressed as a thing-like objectivity. In English translations, this dinglich mostly is translated as material, as objective. It doesn't really meet the German sense. Therefore, I use here the word thing-like objectivity. And this is the basis for what Marx calls fetishism. Social relations take the form of thing-like attributes, and by this they gain not just objectivity, they gain a new type of objectivity between a natural objectivity of a thing and a pure abstract of objectivity of a thought. It is another kind of objectivity, that a relation takes the form of this thing-like objectivity. Important here is that this kind of fetishism is neither a form of wrong consciousness or a kind of deception. In capitalism, it is a reality. It is not a deception. It exists in it exists as a real fact in capitalism. There is not only commodity fetishism, there is also money and capital fetishism. Always the fact is a social relation appears as a thing-like objectivity. But furthermore, besides these three forms of fetishism, we have also what Marx called mystifications. Mystifications we have to distinguish from fetishism. The most important mystification is the wage form. Wages understand as payment for the value of labor. This is a mystification. Why? Because there is no value of labor. Value can be represented, labor can be represented in value, but labor as such is not an object of value. And insofar, to see wages as payment for the value of labor is a mystification. When you continue reading Capital, you will also see mystifications in the second and in the third volume. Profit interests is also introduced as forms of mystifications, or they include mystifications, and all these mystifications are condensed in the so-called Trinitarian formula, which Marx presented at the end of volume 3. I will come back to this Trinitarian formula very soon and show what it means and for what we can use it. Now, this very short introduction should give some sense what I mean when I talk about form analysis, that you know approximately what I mean with this. And now I will start to discuss the political implications for the understanding of the subjects I mentioned: class, revolutionary subject, and very briefly, state and socialism, communism. So let's start with class. All the readings of Capital stress that surplus value is the result of the exploitation of the working class. The capitalist class is the exploiting class, the working class is the exploited class. This is absolutely true, but in some respect, a banality. And it is not at all a discovery of Marx. This was discussed also decades before Marx from the so-called left Ricardians. And it is a fact which holds not only for capitalism, but for every class society. In every class society, you have an exploited class producing the means of subsistence, producing wealth, but receiving only a part of this wealth. And you have an exploiting class appropriating the surplus product, not the surplus value, but the surplus product. When we stop at this point, when we just stress this elementary relation of exploitation, that you have an exploiting class and an exploited class, we just stress the common features of all class societies, but we don't stress any specificity of exploitation in capitalism. However, this was the main task for Marx, to analyze the specific form of capitalist exploitation. And this specific form of capitalist exploitation also reveals certain specific attributes of the working class in capitalism. In pre-capitalist societies, exploitation rests on an appropriation of a surplus product, an appropriation which is based on personal dependence, like slavery or serfdom. So the worker is, as a slave, personal dependent from the owner of him or herself. It is an appropriation in pre-capitalist societies which has absolutely nothing to do with an exchange process. It is a pure relation of domination. In capitalism, we have an appropriation of the surplus product in the form of surplus value. Commodities play a role. Exploitation in capitalism is a result of a specific exchange process, the buying and selling of labor power. And capitalism, in capitalism, we still find examples of slavery. But basically, capitalism does not depend on slavery. The in somehow normal or usual process in capitalism is not slavery, but the contract with the so-called free worker or free laborer. In at least in developed capitalist societies, meanwhile, the workers are politically free persons, legally equal to the capitalists, and without personal dependence. They do a contract and they can solve the labor contract, what was not a thing, what was not possible for the slave or for the serf in the Middle Ages. Exploitation in capitalism takes place in a framework of a contract between free and equal contractors. For liberals, this fact is a proof that in capitalism we don't have exploitation, that we live in the best of all possible worlds. You can do the contracts you ever want to do, and both do this to the mutual advantage. Against this liberal position, leftists usually stress that legally free and equal is not the same as materially free and equal. The workers are forced to sell their labor power by their economic conditions. Labor power is the only property for the mass of the working class. So by the silent force, by the silent power of economic relations, the workers are forced to sell, formally in a voluntary act, their labor power. And furthermore, we have not only an antagonism in distribution, in the relation of distribution, we also have in capitalism an antagonism in the production process. The worker is used as a tool for valorization, and insofar we have a contradiction between the immediate life interests of workers and capital's interest in valorization. The result is permanent struggle as well on an individual level, as well on a collective level as class struggle. All this is absolutely true and also important, but what I want to stress here in at this point that this class struggle, what is considered until now in the discussion here, is a necessary struggle for the working class in order to exist inside the bourgeois society. It is not at all a revolutionary struggle. But mostly at this point starts the discussion about the revolutionary subject. And very often the question when you talk about revolutionary subject is not what could be the revolutionary subject. The question is more who is the revolutionary subject. To put the question in this way presupposes that there already exists a revolutionary subject. Maybe it is a sleeping subject, a subject who is not recognizing the task to do revolution, but a subject which already exists. And many Marxists see their task in precisely determining who is this revolutionary subject and why this is the revolutionary subject. A lot of different answers are given, of course, all of them with the intention to contribute to awake this sleeping subject, to prepare it for the historical task. Already the young Marx started with such attempts in 1843. He thought the working class is the revolutionary subject because it is the suffering class and the class which is excluded from society. And only by revolution, this class can get its human existence. In 1844, it was the alienation of the workers. Only by revolution, the alienated existence could be overcome. And insofar, the alienated class has to do revolution. In Communist Manifesto in 1848, alienation was not anymore an issue. Here it was the immiseration of the working class. The need for revolution was caused by the need to survive. In 1850s, Marx believed, like he expressed, for example, in class struggle in France, that with the next crisis, the next revolution will come. Later, especially after 1857, Marx became more cautious. And I think this higher degree of caution had to do with the insights of his form analysis, which developed only after 1857 with Grundrisse and the different manuscripts preparing Capital. The form aspects of the working class in capitalism are indeed enormously important. That the workers act as free and equal persons, also under economic pressure, this we should never forget, but they act as free and equal persons, and this is not just an illusion. It brings possibilities which are very important for the action and for the consciousness of the workers. They have the possibility to dissolve contracts. They can get rid of awful capitalists. And when there is a period of prosperity, there is even a chance to get better jobs, better paid jobs, and so on. The workers can organize in unions. They can act collectively for their interests, and as citizens, it needed the whole 19th century to reach this. They even can vote for political parties. They can participate in political processes. All this is, of course, not abolishing capitalism, but it gives possibilities, real possibilities, and not just illusions you have to dismiss. And this has consequences for the class and for the individuals, of course. There are in somehow options for individual behavior as well for collective behavior inside the bourgeois society to improve the situation of the workers beyond revolution. Revolution is not the only option when you are not satisfied with your situation. Insofar, it is not at all clear that the members of the working class will develop class consciousness. Maybe they try to fight isolated or in small groups, because the class is divided in a lot of different segments. But even when the working class, or when big parts of the working class, develop class consciousness, this does not at all mean that after a while, a kind of revolutionary class consciousness will develop. And to illustrate this, or to give more reason for this, more details, we have now to consider the Trinitarian formula I already mentioned when I spoke about what means form analysis. The Trinitarian formula, which Marx presents at the end of volume 3 of Capital. The thing of the Trinitarian formula is rather simple. We have three factors of production: capital, labor, and land. They have to cooperate in order to produce. And the three groups of persons who own these three factors, capitalists own the capital, the workers have the labor power, and the landowners have the land, they will receive a part of the commonly produced value as a kind of revenue. The capitalists receive profit or interest, the laborers receive wages, the landowners receive land rent. This Marx presents at the end of volume 3 as a necessary picture which capitalism itself produces. It is not a kind of ideological picture which is produced by some theoreticians of capitalism, by some philosophers or economists. No, it is a picture which capitalism itself produces as a kind of natural structure of human production. And the ideologies or the economic theories are just based on this spontaneously produced picture. Like, for example, we can find this in especially in Adam Smith or Jean-Baptiste Say, or even when you open a contemporary textbook of economics, very often it starts even with such a picture of the three factors of production and the three kind of income or revenue which these factors receive. This Trinitarian formula now is important for three issues. First, the notion of justice. Second, for the self-perception of the worker. And third, for the image of the state. Perception of justice. There can be, of course, a kind of unjust distribution. The three factors contribute to production, and they receive something. And this should be according to their contribution. When now, for example, capital receives a lot and labor receives only a little share, people can say, oh, it is unjust. There is a justice gap. For example, in Germany, in the election campaign from 1998, which brought for the first time a red-green government to Federal Republic of Germany, this was the parole of the Social Democrats. We have a justice gap between capital and labor. And this is pure Trinitarian formula. It means it is not questioned the capitalist mode of production as such. It is only questioned that inside the capitalist mode of production, we have a kind of unjust relation. And this is an idea produced by this, or based on this Trinitarian formula, not an idea produced by some ideologies. No, it is an idea based in the social relations and these thing-like objectivities of value, profit, and so on. Second important point regarding Trinitarian formula is the self-perception of the workers. I already mentioned that in capitalism, the workers are usually politically free and legally equal persons. The Trinitarian formula transfers this equality to the level of class. We have the three factors of production. These factors of production hold by different classes. And the idea connected with the Trinitarian formula is that these classes basically have equal rights, they can have equal claims, and there must be a kind of balance between these classes. So the individual equality or legal equality that each person has the same legal rights transfers to the claim that also the big classes should have the same rights or the same possibilities to do social or political claims. And this also will lead to political conflicts, but all these conflicts are inside the bourgeois society. They don't question the basic structure of capitalism and of bourgeois society. And now the third point, state. When you have such competing interests and injustice between production factors, when you have equal classes or classes which should have equal claims, but they don't can really equally claim something, you need a referee. You need someone who confirms, yes, this is an accepted claim. Here we have an unjust relation. And this neutral referee is, according to this framework of Trinitarian formula, the state. The state appears as an instance beyond the single interests of the single classes, or at least it should be beyond, and act as a kind of neutral referee. Also, this is not an illusion. A good part of the laws of the bourgeois state rest on this neutrality. The state, the bourgeois state, secures private property of everybody. The state secures the private property that I have with my bicycle. When the bicycle is stolen, the state will try to find the thief. And the state, of course, secures the private property of an owner of a big company. Also, the big company shall not be stolen. So, but in doing this neutral act to secure every property, of course, the state confirms to the material inequality that I have only a bicycle and someone else has a whole company and is able to buy a lot of labor power and so on. So the neutrality of the state, it is not an illusion. It is it is even a tool to secure class structure, class domination and the capitalist mode of production. But of course, this is a neutrality inside the bourgeois structures. Very often the state is not neutral. Very often the state is captured by a capital fraction or a certain lobby group. Then this is a scandal, but this is a bourgeois scandal. This is not a point, really a scandal, when you want to criticize capitalist mode of production and state, that the state is not neutral, is not a proof of anything. It is just a proof that the normal bourgeois functioning of the state has a problem. So when we now take this together, the three points I just mentioned from Trinitarian formula, a certain perception of justice, a self-perception of the workers, and a perception of the state as a neutral referee, it should be clear that this gives the background, of course, for a certain class consciousness, for a certain kind of class struggle, which belongs to the capitalist society and which is not at all close to revolution. It is just the normal process of reproducing capitalism, which is not a smooth, friendly project. No, it is a very fierce, questioned, contested process. In Capital, Marx stresses these points, but he also stresses the opposite. In Capital, you find on the one hand this very famous remark that the workers are submitted to capitalism and that they accept capitalism as a kind of natural order. To read one sentence which expresses this very nicely. The organization of the capitalist process of production, once it is fully developed, breaks down all resistance. The constant generation of a relative surplus population keeps the law of the supply and demand of labor, and therefore wages, within narrow limits which correspond to capital's valorization requirements. The silent compulsion of economic relations sets the seal on the domination of the capitalist over the worker. Direct extra economic force is still, of course, used, but only in exceptional cases. In the ordinary run of things, the workers can be left to the natural laws of production. When you read only this, it sounds rather pessimistic that capital dominates. It appears as a kind of natural law. The quote, probably you recognized it. It is from volume one, from the section on primitive accumulation. But it takes already in account what I try to explain with the help of the Trinitarian formula. And when you read only this, you must think, okay, there is no chance that the working class ever will be revolutionary. Capital breaks every resistance. However, at the end of this section on primitive accumulation, in the chapter on the historical tendency of capitalist accumulation, we can read the following: that with the progress of capitalist development, the mass of misery, oppression, slavery, degradation, and exploitation grows, but with this, there also grows the revolt of the working class, a class constantly increasing in numbers and trained, united, and organized by the very mechanism of the capitalist process of production. So while around 30 pages before, it was said, capital breaks every resistance. Now it is said that the working class will revolve, and it is even organized and trained by the capitalist production. It is nearly the opposite of the first quote I gave. That these quotes contradicts in this way, I think, is not a problem of stupidity, that Marx forgot something. It is the correct description of what we find in capitalism. We have, on the one hand, very strong mechanisms to break any resistance, to split the working class, to break resistance, to get rid of revolts, on the one hand. And on the other hand, always, again and again, there you have good reasons to revolt, and there are also attempts to revolt. However, I think for the second scenario, what most Marxists, of course, like, and in many cases, they only occupy with this, the second scenario, that there will be a revolt and at the end, capitalism will overcome, there is a chance. But the first scenario, that the resistance is broken, it happens much, much more often. Having this in the background of our mind, we should have a different look to the discussion, the very often discussion about revolutionary classes, and what is a revolutionary class. Already I sketched a little bit this discussion. The Marxists want to discover who is the revolutionary subject, which is unfortunately sleeping. We want to awake it, and then the revolt and revolution will happen. All this presupposes that a revolutionary development is just the normal case. And when we don't see a revolutionary development, not a revolution, but a revolutionary development, we must look which factors, which conditions prevent this revolutionary development. Maybe bourgeois ideology, the medias, or the high wages for a workers' aristocracy. All these were reasons which were formulated in the discussions of the last 100 years. Considering Marx's form analysis, I think we have to reverse the whole consideration. Unfortunately, the absence of revolutionary tendencies is the normality in capitalism. And the existence of revolutionary tendencies depends on special historical factors. I think there is not to discover a kind of revolutionary subject, what is just sleeping or waiting until its hour will come. A revolution or a revolt can happen, and then in this revolution, a revolutionary subject constitutes. But the search for this revolutionary subject without revolution, I think it is a kind of political alchemy, like in medieval ages, the alchemists looked for this magic stone which can transfer the chemical elements in each other. This stone doesn't exist. And insofar, I would say a revolutionary subject without revolution also doesn't exist. It constitutes when in a revolutionary process, in a revolutionary event, and after this revolutionary event, no matter if it is somehow successful or not, the revolutionary subject will disappear. The revolutionary subject without revolution, I think, cannot exist. It is a kind of chimera, this revolutionary subject. Insofar, my consequence is not to say, okay, we should have no hope for revolutions or for fundamentally changing capitalism. Of course, I want to have such a fundamental change, and I hope that one day it will come, and perhaps I also will be a part of this. But to see this revolutionary tendency as an objective tendency which is always there, this, I think, is a very bad illusion. Now, as my last point, I just said that I don't give up the hope for overcoming capitalism. The question is, what comes then? What means socialism, communism? And this will be my last point to say very briefly what we can learn from Marx's form analysis about socialism, communism, what it is, and especially what it is not. Form analysis, in my view, brings a rather basic argument against any forms of market socialism. Market socialism, which has the idea that capitalist property is abolished. We have only association, production associations. They organize together the production, but they compete on markets, maybe regulated by a socialist state. This is a form of conception of socialism, which became especially popular after we saw the shortcomings of a system like the Soviet Union, with a central planned economy, which didn't work, and which was the central planning also a source of nation and power, and not at all the end of domination. However, from Marx's form analysis, I see a very basic argument against such a market socialism. In the analysis of the value form in chapter one, it was shown that we cannot have a commodity circulation without money. And we don't need money just as a practical helper. This also a bourgeois economist would agree, but we need money as the necessary expression of value objectivity. This argument Marx used against the conception of socialism of Proudhon, who wanted, or who had the idea socialism is still private commodity production, but without money. And Marx tried to show this is not possible when you have commodity production, private commodity production, you have circulation, or you need circulation, you need money, it is not possible. This argument Marx also continued, especially in Grundrisse and in the original draft of a contribution to the Critique of Political Economy. He showed that there is a similar strong connection between money and capital. Money as money, as Marx calls this in the third chapter of Capital, money as the independent expression of value, is on the one hand the last result of commodity circulation, but it cannot exist in a pure commodity circulation. And market socialism, in some respect, presupposes such a kind of pure commodity circulation. The argument we can find, especially in Grundrisse, is that money as money, money as the independent expression of value, needs capital circulation. Commodity circulation is not enough. For market socialism, when this argument of Marx is correct, and I would say for me it sounds very convincing, when this argument is correct, then market socialism has always a tendency to transform into a market capitalism. For a market capitalism, you don't need an individual capitalist. To be a capitalist, already this we can learn in Capital, is not necessarily an attribute of a single person. It is an attribute of a certain imperative to follow the imperative of valorization of value. And of course, this imperative can also be followed by an association. You don't need a single capitalist or a capitalist shareholder company. Also an association can do this. So from form analysis, or this form, the arguments of form analysis, I think market socialism is not at all an alternative to capitalism. On the other hand, criticizing market socialism doesn't mean that now the only possibility is to have an economy which is planned by a center from top down, like we had it in the Soviet Union. The task, and I think in Marx, in the critique of the Gotha program, came rather close to a formulation of this task. The task is to have associations of producers and consumers which cooperate in a conscious way. And cooperation in a conscious way means to go beyond all these form determinations we have in a market. So what the form analysis reveals has the aim to overcome the social conditions which produces these forms and which makes a form analysis necessary. And this overcoming of the conditions of forms, of capitalist forms, we have only when we substitute market mechanisms by conscious mechanisms of cooperations, where communities, associations negotiate what they want, what they can contribute to the common goal, satisfying the needs, and what they themselves need. This is not at all a simple way, and there is also not a ready-made recipe for this. And even when such a process will start one day, there is absolutely no security that such a process will be successful, or that such an economy will not collapse and we come back to markets. But I think it is the only possible alternative to capitalism. And I think to make this clear that this is the only possible, it is also one of the achievements of Marx's form analysis. And insofar, I think we can use this form analysis for a number of important, for the discussing of a number of important issues, and perhaps even overcome some shortcomings of existing discussions. So I want to finish now at this point and say thank you for your attention. And now I think we can start with questions and discussion.
Thanks very much, Michael. I'm sure there will be a lot of questions. I think the best way to handle it is to have Kyle Kubler be a kind of a traffic controller. And I will turn it over to Kyle, who has who can call on people, or I guess even send a note on chat saying it's your turn. But the idea is that if you want to ask the question, we'd love to have you do it live, or it can be read out by Kyle if you would rather not have your image associated with the question. So Kyle, take it away. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Well, we'll just pass it over to Sean, and then we'll go Assad and Cordelia after that.
Great. Thanks, Kyle and Philip. And thank you very much, Michael, for another really amazing talk, always really informative and insightful. I sort of thought I might ask you initially about the concept of class in Marx's writings and how it changes over time, you know, looking at the sort of trans-historical concept of class we find in the Communist Manifesto, right? The claim that all history hitherto is the history of class struggle, but you know, comparing that with the historically specific concept of class and capital. But I was struck on a completely different note, or a relatively different note, I suppose, by some comments you made towards the end of your talk about this idea that the existence of revolutionary tendencies depends on specific historical factors, you know, against this idea that revolution is something that's always lying dormant and just needs to be awakened. And so I guess I have two questions for you. One is, which historical factors do you have in mind? And how do you see them sort of bearing on revolutionary possibility? And second, whether or not they lend themselves at a schematic level, perhaps, to some sort of periodizing model of anti-capitalist struggle, communist struggle, revolutionary struggle, however you want to characterize that.
Shall I answer at once, or do you want to collect some questions?
Maybe we should collect two at a time and three at a time, and then you can answer.
I wanted to ask you about Marx's understanding of emancipation, how you see this. You kind of came close to it in talking about the revolutionary subject. As I understand it, in 1843, Marx proposes this distinction between political emancipation and human emancipation, and it's the reabsorption of the abstract citizen into the concrete individual and the alienated powers in the state into the human community. And then, as you pointed out, It's the fact that the proletariat is the part of the society which is excluded, which makes it universal. And then there's a theory of alienation, which is that all of the relations of society, all of the servitude of society is concentrated in the production process. And that's also a philosophy of history, which says that this, you know, is kind of emancipation is kind of the goal towards history is tending. And I think we agree that he does not think that for very long, but he continues to talk about emancipation without giving another theory. So I wonder if you think this is still an important concept in light of his later form analysis, and what would it be?
Okay. A third question, or?
Yeah, I can ask my question. So in this talk, you presented an argument against market socialism on the grounds of Marx's form analysis, and also incidentally mentioned a critique of central planning on the grounds of its continuation of domination. And so you say instead that the task is to have associations of producers and consumers, which cooperate in a conscious way. And so you've also spoken in some past talks about Marx's communism as, in a sense, a kind of radical individualism. So my question is, in what sense is the subordination of individuals to the collective decisions of an association not a form of domination to the extent that central planning is one? And then on the other hand, why should we believe that the result of deliberation within an association, regardless of the mechanisms for entry of an association or what have you, is responsive to social need and is responsive to the development of the free individual?
Sorry, could you just repeat your last sentence? I didn't get it.
Sorry. So I said, on the other hand, why should we believe that the result of deliberation within an association is responsive to either social need or the development of the free individual?
Okay, now I got it. Thank you.
Okay, sorry about that.
Okay. I think this is for the first round enough. I try to answer briefly, and then we can continue with other questions. Okay, I will try to answer in the order of the question. The question of historical factors for revolution. The point is capitalism. When Marx in Capital gives us a rather general abstract picture of capitalism, which I think is also true today, no matter what changes the concrete capitalism has undergone. And this abstract picture already shows there is a contradiction between capital's need for valorization and the life interests of the majority of the people, of the working class, but also beyond working class. Capitalism is destructive to nature, and this undermines the living conditions of the whole society. Insofar, there is a good reason always to abolish capitalism, to revolt against capitalism. I think in this point, we probably all agree, but not always revolution or revolt happens. It is the exception. And this exception happens, we can just look in history, it happens only in very special situations. When you look, for example, Paris Commune, the Russian Revolution 1905, Russian Revolution 1917, German Revolution 1918. All these happened after the estate had lost a war. The whole social reproduction was disturbed. The government lost any trust. And I will not say the majority of the people, but a good part of the people said, okay, we have now no other chance than to act in this revolutionary way. I don't say it is necessary. There is a necessity that first a war has to be lost and then revolution starts. I say this only to give you an example. At least when we look in history, we can see it must have a very strong shakening of normality. But that just the everyday life in capitalism becomes worse and worse, and then people say, oh, now let's do a revolution. At least I don't have an example for this. And in so far, I think I cannot really answer your question. You said, which historical factors? I don't have a theory of this, and I doubt if a theory exists. It is a moment of historical arbitrariness. So when history is not a determined process ruled from some necessities, I think we have problems to give a complete list of the reasons which can lead to revolution. At least I don't have one. And also, your second question was with periodizing. I think we can try to periodize the development of capitalism. There are some periods, but to connect this to revolutions, I also don't see how this should work. And so far, I'm sorry, I must also disappoint you with an answer to your second question. Now, the question about emancipation. You mentioned this early concept of Marx, where in the Jewish question, he distinguished political emancipation and human emancipation. Such a distinction later he never did. I think it was a step in learning, in understanding the political and the social structure of bourgeois society. It was exactly in Jewish question. Jewish question has two parts, which are totally different. And between writing part one and part two, probably he read the book of Moses Hess about money. So it was the point where really money and economic theory, where he entered in this new field, and this was reflected. So this distinction, political and human emancipation, I think it is a very short, brief conception, which played later no role. However, emancipation played a role the whole lifetime of Marx and in all his attempts to do something, to write something. Emancipation was important, but emancipation for Marx, for the later Marx, this also was mentioned, I think in the third question, I stressed in the past, emancipation in Marx is a rather individualistic category. And this we can see already in the Communist Manifesto. You remember probably this famous sentence of Communist Manifesto about the future society, where the freedom, the free development of each single individual is the condition for the development of all. So each individual must have the possibility to develop. This is an individualistic concept of communism. And this individualistic concept is the basis for the whole. And it repeats. Marx didn't write a text about communism, but you can find a lot of sentences in Grundrisse, also in Capital, where always it is stressed, a non-capitalist society, a higher form of society, he mentioned in the volume one of Capital, a higher form of society where the development of the individual is the aim and not the valorization of value. So emancipation as an individual emancipation is important, but what is the distinction between Marx and the liberals? A liberal would hear me, he say, yes, so we can say Marx is one of the first liberals and he can enter each liberal party. No, because Marx reflects what are the social and economic conditions for this individual emancipation. And the condition is, for example, to abolish private property in the means of production. And now we also see the liberal is leaving when he hears this, and there is no danger that he thinks Marx is an ancestor of modern liberalism. And this, you ask me also if the concept stayed. Yes, it stayed. And even we can make it develop it a little bit more, thinking of political organizations. There is this famous sentence from the the inaugural address of the First International, where Marx stresses the liberation of the working class can only be the act of the working class. And this is also a point we should never forget. When you have a political party, when you have a trade union or so, all this is only a tool, but such an organization can never do the act only the class can do. And this is we all know this, a very bad tradition in history of communist organizations, that the party was set instead of the class and the party leaders instead of the whole party. So this emancipation, it is an individual emancipation, what can only be done, be acted for, fight for, executed by the collective of these individuals and not a kind of representative. I think these both moments go together. And this leads me to the last question. When I have it correctly in mind, it had two parts. If I sketched an idea of socialism, associations of producers and consumers have to negotiate in a conscious way, not by mediated by markets and not by a central planning. And I think the question was, is there not also a subordination of individuals first? And where can I take the security that such associations really responds to social needs? First, of course, when an association, also inside the association, is doing something, you have a kind of subordination of the individuals. Human life is impossible to such a subordination. We all here, all I can see you, we are subordinated to the plannings of Red May that at this time, 11 o'clock in Seattle, 8 p.m. in Berlin time, we meet and we have our common discussion. The discussion would not be possible if we wouldn't subordinate to this plan. So a certain kind of subordination is necessary when humans want to cooperate. But the kind of subordination, or the subordination can have very different kinds. Is there a kind of force? Nobody of us is forced to subordinate. We can leave this meeting. Nothing will happen. There is no one who presses us. We also can vote in groups. If, let us say, a lot of persons would say, yeah, this time is not so good. Can we transfer this meeting to another time? It would be possible. And in so far, we have a kind of voluntarily subordination, and this is absolutely okay. Of course, groups can change from a voluntarily subordination to a forced. Then we have to leave such groups or to change the groups. There is also no security that there is never a change, but again, this is the only way. That this association answer to social needs, there is no security. Also an association can act in a very egoistic way, then other associations have to counteract. And when nothing else helps, then this association of associations has to split. But of course, there is in no human association, you have a security that everything goes smooth. And of course, in a socialist or communist society, there is also not such a guarantee. I said in my talk, even it is possible that everything breaks down and we will see a kind of regression from such a socialist attempt back to markets and capitalism. Nobody can exclude this. So here I want to stop and we can have more questions.
Great, thank you. I'll go to Jasper and then Philip, and I will ask a question from our YouTube viewers as well.
Am I live now?
Yeah, go for it.
Thanks, Mikhail, for your talk and for taking all these questions. I'm interested in your understanding of Marx's theory of tendency. And it seems that in your view, there's certainly no tendency towards revolution. And I take that point. There's no teleology in Marx, but nonetheless, it does seem that for Marx, there was a certain directionality to history. And he outlines numerous tendencies. I think there were probably 30 of them. And they align with each other in contradictory ways. But in the end, they add up to produce something that is a transformation. It seems like sometimes in your notion of the tendency, it's kind of like it could go one way or it could go another way. Who knows? And the same thing in your account of what communism is like. It could fail or it could not. But as I understand Marx, history has a kind of directionality. There are changes that are irreversible. And in his understanding of capitalism, there's this process of a kind of real transformation of the labor process. And it's not clear you can run that backwards. And with that comes, you know, this whole discussion of class composition, which I think is not simply a distributional matter, you know, as the Trinity formula may make it seem, but really also has to do with sort of the concrete division of labor and rearrangement of people now in a kind of global factory. So, you know, I guess, yeah, that's what I would ask. Is there nonetheless, for Marx, a direction to history? And then, you know, I would like to distinguish between Marxology and getting things right. Or for you, is there still nonetheless a direction to capitalism?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, this is a sort of minor example of directionality that Jasper talked about, but the question is on the changing role of the state in the last 7 or 8 years, which seems to go way beyond the notion of collective capitalists that we find in the chapter on the working day. Not only is the state now bailing out the companies and setting a permanent safety net below, not allowing Schumpeterian creative destruction, not allowing that to operate, however many times capital talks about that, or the representatives. But with quantitative easing, they are buoying up asset prices, which they're never gonna let fall. And this seems to have been factored in by a sort of perverse rational expectation by capital, in the notion that once these things start to happen, they expect them as the norm, so that any attempt to walk them back, for example, the waiver of patents, this mere suggestion of the waiver of patents produces a rumble, suggesting that the attempt to walk back intellectual property to any kind of reasonable form that it was earlier is never going to be allowed to happen without essentially a strong counter-revolution. So my question is as follows. It has to do, one, they are buoying up profits. They're trying to guarantee profits, and they seem committed and locked in to this kind of path-dependent notion where they're going to inflate asset prices and rents. And that seems to be the only way that capital can conceive of continuing now. What's happening to value as they do all this? We know that they essentially can guarantee profits, but essentially, are they not creating more value? And will this have some sort of consequence? And two, I know there is a tendency to look at one's present moment and come up with a new stage of capitalism, like late capitalism or monopoly capitalism. But in this evolution of the role of the state, are we looking at something new? So that's the question.
And then I'll turn it over to Stephen to ask one question, and then we'll get the YouTube comments in our next round.
Michael, thank you. That was a great talk. The title of the talk was The Political Impact of Marx's Form Analysis. And it struck me that it was going to be how Marx's form analysis would in turn inform the way we carry on political activities and move forward on a level of practice. I agree with you that moving in a direction of market socialism is definitely problematic, and that's not gonna make us move forward. But I'm wondering, does our understanding of Marx's form analysis in terms of the commodity form, capital form, money form, et cetera, value form, is that in some way give us an idea as to what concrete political actions, in addition to the historical conditions, what kind of concrete political actions we should undertake? Do they need to be those that focus on striking out against any sort of markets or striking out against any sort of or avoiding those kinds of activities that don't strike at or speak to the heart of value form. It seems to me that that would be a kind of like leap to go from where we are today to get to a point where our practical activities have to be directed towards the abolition of the value form. But nonetheless, I'd like to see how you address the question of that transition in a practical level.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Okay, I will try what I can say to all these questions. Again, I will try to do it in the order of the questions. First to Jasper, the question of teleology, direction of history, and so on. I think in Marx, Marx started with a strong teleology in the 1840s. And this teleology, the idea there is a direction of history, became weaker and weaker. In Communist Manifesto, it is very strong. Even when we come to the preface of the first volume of Capital, there is this sentence, the country which is more developed shows to the less developed country its future. Comparing England with Germany, the Germans shouldn't say, oh, we don't have to do with all this, but no, England shows Germany its future. Already in the French edition, he inserted industrialized. So the more developed industrialized country shows the way of industrialization. It was much more narrow. And then in the end of the 1870s, when Marx was asked by the editorial board of a Russian journal about his section on primitive accumulation, is this the general road for history, so that every society first has to become from pre-capitalist conditions to capitalist conditions, and then from capitalist conditions to socialist or communist society. Marx argued very defensive, saying, oh, this was only the description of the way of England, but without a general claim. And there he is explicit against any philosophy of history which claims we know what are the tendencies, we know what happened. So this letter from, I think, 1878 is a very strong negation of a general direction in history. What he was doing still also in the 70s in Capital was to give much, or to describe much narrower economic tendencies. There is, of course, a tendency for accumulation. Capital needs accumulation, needs to grow, but also then crisis comes, destroys capital, accumulated capital, splits capital. There is not even a tendency that always bigger capitals will emerge. What was later said in these different kind of theories of monopoly capitalism, Marx always had the two possibilities. Capital can become bigger and it can split and become also smaller. There is attraction and repulsion, he mentioned. So I would say he became very, very cautious in the course of the 1870s. And you asked also for my my opinion. I would even radicalize this this position I see in Marx. I don't say it was really Marx's position. I would argue against any teleology. You have in capitalism, you have good reason for revolution. We have good arguments that this fucking capitalism has to be abolished. But in my view, we cannot say history is on our side. There are the objective tendencies undermining capitalism. And when not in this decade, then in the next or in the next decade. This, for this, there is no no reason. There is a chance, but absolutely no guarantee. And the same for me holds also for every non-capitalist project or society. Of course, I want to start such a non-capitalist society and economy, and we can think about what to do. But also here, there is no security that there is not a kind of regression, that it falls back. I don't, at least I don't see an argument which could be decisive. You mentioned then also capitalist developments, tendencies in the labor process, in the composition of the working class. Yes, these are certain tendencies, but that a capitalist economy, perhaps can have such a deep crisis that very advanced form of the labor process of real subsumption will be destroyed. I don't see an argument that this is impossible. And in so far, we can observe certain tendencies now, but that these tendencies will remain and give us any security in the future, at least I don't see an argument for this. This, in some respect, holds also for Philip's question. You speak of a changing role of the state. I'm not so sure if the role of the state is really changing so fundamentally. Bailing out by the state happened also in former times. Maybe not so often, not so on such a big level, but it's also not completely new. There's one point I'm not sure if I understood you correctly. You said, yes, the state can guarantee profits, but what is with value when there is not more value production, this process comes to an end when there is not any more value creating. This thesis that we are already in a process of diminishing value production or so, I absolutely not share. In Germany, we had a group and a theoretician, Robert Kurz, who very fiercely had this thesis that we have a lot of labor spent, but this labor produces less and less value. To this, I oppose completely. I think this thesis rests on a very substantialist notion of value, which I think is completely wrong for analyzing capitalism. And insofar, I don't see that less value is produced or less value is here. This, I think, is not a problem for capitalism. The problem, or one of the problem in the moment, is the enormous destructive character of capitalism, that value profits is produced with a lot of destructions of nature and of humans. And here is the question, how long this will be possible without touching the development of capitalism. And here I'm also not sure that this will go on, that capitalism always will find a solution. No, also, of course, like socialism can break down, also capitalism can destroy in such an extent its condition that it cannot exist anymore. But this not necessarily means that we have any good development after this. Already Rosa Luxemburg's famous sentence, socialism or barbary, she had in mind the idea capitalism will come to an end. She had also a kind of collapse theory, but this collapse will be so enormously awful that we have to do before revolution in order to avoid this destructive collapse. So now the last question, concrete political action, a transition period from the bad capitalist reality to a better socialist or communist reality. I think there is a kind of hints we can get from form analysis. I wouldn't exaggerate. It is not a theory where you can derive every political action. Shall I support this demonstration or not? And this I give reason with form analysis. I don't think that this is so easily possible, but I think we can say something. When market socialism is not a solution, then it will also not be a solution or a transitional step to say, yeah, we need a better regulation of markets. For example, this is okay, this programs maybe in the tradition of Keynes, of a social democracy, they will help to improve a very bad situation that people are impoverished. For example, when you have, like in Germany, you have money for unemployed persons. When you are sick, you cannot work because of sickness, your employer has to pay the first 6 weeks. After this, the health insurance have to work. Of course, such conditions are much better for the individuals than when you don't have such conditions. But basically, they don't question capitalism. They provide capitalism or capital with a constant supply of labor force. Of course, such measures help the individual worker, but on a level of society, it also helps capital to get access to the labor force. When you want to do really measures which can be considered as a first step beyond capitalism, I think you have to take out a part of social reality, a part of the economy, from the valorization imperative. For example, we have just current in Berlin. Berlin as a as an urban center has very high housing rents, very high housing prices. And there is an initiative to confiscate the houses of big housing companies when they own more than 3,000 apartments. So that housing is not anymore part of the capitalist circulation, profit circulation. But the idea is not that just the state should confiscate and then the state should administrate the confiscated apartments and houses, but that there should be a kind of common administration where the persons who live in the confiscated houses, together with organizations of society who represent the society, that the not only the persons who live in these houses now develop their egoistic interest for better living, can decide about these houses. And this, I think, is a very progressive initiative that on the one hand, to take away an important part important for the life of people away from capitalist valorization and find new kinds of administration of these kinds, of these parts. And this is also, I think, a strategy which you can try to implement for more sectors. Still, you will have capitalism. This is not an abolishing of capitalism, but it is a change which, in my view, goes in the correct direction. While, for example, to have a better aid for unemployed persons, I also would support this, no question. But this has absolutely nothing to do with a step beyond capitalism.
Thanks. We do have another round of three, if you have the time and the energy for that.
Yeah.
Great. So I'll read the first one from the YouTube comments that we got. So this one reads, you said that abstract labor does not exist within the production process, but doesn't it exist as a form of compulsion, even ideally, not yet realized as the capitalist aim for the average rate of profit? This compulsion has very real consequences on the production process in regards to intensity and productivity, which are directly related to the value realized in exchange. So it must be represented. That was the YouTube question as best as I could compile it from a couple different posts, but I'll turn it over to Kailash and then Kate for their questions.
Hi, thanks a lot for the talk. So I have a question, it's like a Marxology type question, which is, in chapter one, Marx's assumption behind the economy is that of independent private producers, a commercial society. That's not necessarily capitalist, predates its emergence. You can find it in like the pre-Islamic Arabian Peninsula. If value is historically specific to capitalism and, you know, the topic at hand is the capital labor relation, why doesn't he start with his novel like interpretation of what a capitalist society is instead of what is actually bourgeois political economy's assumption of what?
Just to be sure that I understood correctly, the question is, why does Marx not start at once with a capitalist society?
Yeah.
Okay, I got it. Okay, and another question?
Hi, yeah. Thank you so much for your talk. That was really quite interesting. I was interested in your answer, actually, to one of the previous questions about sort of what are the historical conditions or accidents that produce kind of revolutionary conditions that might not be sort of always present in capitalism in the way that some people might think that they are. And specifically this idea of a kind of mass disruption of social reproduction as one of the conditions. And I was curious if that, I mean, obviously war was the example, right, that is used, but I guess what's interesting to me about that is thinking through how it's possible to kind of systematically analyze what are the conditions that produce that kind of mass disruption of social reproduction. And how does that connect to the arguments you're making about the kind of composition of the class as such, right? That if the working class is not sort of always this present, sleeping, organized force, how does that question of social reproduction and its disruption relate to the self-creation of the working class as a force for revolution? That's, you know, asking a question about what I like to think about, but I'm curious about what you think about it.
Okay, I will try to answer these questions. Okay, first with abstract labor. Abstract labor, okay, when I understood it correctly, I stressed abstract labor doesn't exist in the production. It is a reduction from concrete to abstraction, and this happens only in the exchange process. And the counter argument then in the question was, but in production, it is expected that something happens. The capitalist has this in mind. So abstract labor must be represented at least ideally in the production. This I think I understood. I hope it was correct. First, the capitalist usually, when he is not by accident a Marxist, doesn't know anything about abstract labor. Maybe he knows something about value, maybe he even has an idea about the difference of value and price, but usually not about abstract labor. But I also said value doesn't exist just because of production. Value exists only when the use value is exchanged and transforms in a commodity. The capitalist has expectations, has considerations. Marx stresses this in a paragraph inserted in Capital in the second edition, in the section on commodity fetishism, where he says, I try to produce now a translation out of my mind. Value objectivity is only reached in exchange before value comes into consideration by the producer. And this is an important difference. Value and abstract labor, I can conclude, doesn't exist before exchange. It comes into consideration. The capitalist is not producing just as an attempt, see what I can do today, and tomorrow I will do it otherwise. No, the capitalist is producing according to certain expectations, and he tries that the expectations are very concrete, very precise from former experience or from knowledge he gets. But nevertheless, it is his consideration or her consideration, her expectation, and not the things as such. Insofar, value and abstract labor play a role in the expectation, but they don't exist. This is the difference I want to do. And I think this is also a difference Marx stressed, at least when he reworked from the first edition, where this was not so clear, to the second edition of Capital, where he did certain changes in wording, but also in paragraphs. I cannot go now in more detail, but it is one of the themes in my book, How to Read Capital, which will appear, I think, in August by from Mansley Review Press. The next question is also treating this the first chapter. I think this is a mistake you have. Of course, Marx starts with the capitalist society. He didn't start with a society of commodity producers, with a pre-capitalist society of commodity producers. This was already a misunderstanding already Frederick Engels had. When you read the first sentence of the first chapter, here I have the Penguin edition, unfortunately. The wealth of societies in which the capitalist mode of production prevails appears as an immense collection of commodities. The individual commodity appears as its elementary form. Our investigation therefore begins with the analysis of the commodity. The commodity Marx introduces in the first paragraph of the first chapter is the capitalist commodity. The commodity in a society in which the capitalist mode of production prevails. Insofar, Marx is speaking from starting with the first sentence about a capitalist society. But he has to do what he announces already in the preface, in the analysis of economic forms. Neither the microscope nor chemical tools can help, only abstraction. Marx, because of his research process, is clear that he cannot start at once with the category capital. He needs first the category value and commodity and the category money. Only then we can discuss what is capital, the famous money, commodity, money circulation. In order to talk about this money, commodity, money, we must know what is money, commodity, money. And therefore, the analysis in chapter one starts with commodity and money. But it is money in capitalism, commodity in capitalism. And there are also on further pages, there are hints where it becomes clear. For example, a few pages later in a footnote where Marx distinguishes, I think, complex and simple labor, he makes a footnote and says, we don't speak here about wage labor, that the reader doesn't think high wages, low wages is the issue. And why we don't speak about wage labor, he says, because the category of wage labor in the moment doesn't exist for us. He doesn't say, I consider social relations where wage labor doesn't consist. He said, for us, the category doesn't exist. Meaning, in this theoretical approach, we didn't reach the category, but of course we are dealing with capital and with capitalism. And of course in capitalism, wage labor exists. And so far, to make the long story short, my answer, Marx starts his capitalist society from the first sentence of the first chapter in Capital. Now to the last question. I'm not sure if I got everything. You went back to the discussion about revolution. I said revolutionary tendencies always need historical circumstances, conditions. And now you mentioned destructive tendencies of capital, crisis of social reproduction, and that this may be also a question or a condition for revolution. I hope I got the question correctly. I must simply say, I don't know. Maybe I don't see an argument which would contradict this. Maybe destruction in the social reproduction can be so so intensively that people don't want to bear this anymore, and a kind of revolt, revolution will appear. I said before, I don't have a kind of theory what are the historically important factors for revolution. A historian could try to do a research about the revolutions which happened in the last 150 years and try if one can come to some generalized propositions. I don't have it. I don't see it. And so far, I can only say maybe. I don't know.
Okay, thank you. It looks like we have maybe two more questions. How does that sound?
Yeah, I'm still fit.
Okay, wonderful. Paul, do you want to go ahead, and then Maya, you can go next.
Do I just unmute myself? Is that fine?
Yeah, you got it.
Now I can hear someone. I don't see someone, but I hear a voice.
I'm not used to Zoom. I'm sorry. How do I focus myself?
You're good. I think you're on the camera now.
Okay. In answering Assad's question, you referenced Marx's statement that the emancipation of the working class can only be the act of the working class, which is sort of the answer that Marx comes to, according to in 1843, the working class is the revolutionary subject for so many reasons, and he sticks with that for so many reasons. I'm wondering, capitalism has gotten a bit messy, and it's sort of hard sometimes to determine the individual class composition of a person. How do we determine who is the working class today?
Okay.
Hi. You mentioned the critique of the Gotha program, and I expected to hear.
Sorry, the critique of?
The Gotha program.
Ah, got it, yeah.
I expected you to give a criticism of the labor certificate and its relationship to kind of pre-monetary theory of value, maybe, that Marx may have had. And I'm wondering actually what you think of the relationship between time and value is, and how does might that problematize the idea of labor certificates based in labor time or not?
But could you say me the last with labor time? What?
Yeah, I'm wondering the relationship between time and value.
Yeah, this I got. But you said a sentence after this.
If we were to have that analysis of capitalism using like a theory of value, how might that instruct us as to the way we might measure not value, but labor? Is that possible? Does your analysis of the value form have anything to say about that? Does that make sense?
But which labor you want to measure? The the commodity producing labor or an
I'm
not
saying that I want to measure any labor time. I'm just wondering what you think of an idea in socialist planning about the measurement of or the payment and the allocation of labor based in labor time.
Okay, now I understand. Now it's clear.
Sorry.
No, everything is okay. Yeah, you said two questions, so I can answer now. Working class today was the question of Paul, when I understood correctly. I must be a little bit more, I must do a small deviation. Marx talked in Communist Manifesto about classes, this famous sentence, all history is history of class struggles. And then he started to enumerate the classes in antiquity, the classes in medieval ages, and then bourgeoisie, proletariat in modern times. But there is not a discussion, what is class? He just took the notion of class, and some years later, in a letter to his friend Weidemeyer, who was in US in this time already, he wrote to him, I discovered the existence of classes nor that of class struggles. Already historians had discovered this. I only discovered that the class struggle will end in the dictatorship of the proletariat and finally in the abolishing of all class structures. This is a very revealing sentence, not the dictatorship of the proletariat, but that he took the notion of class just from historians. So he had not at this time really a theoretically filled notion of class. He found also the notion of class in Ricardo, for example. And also in this time, he took the notion of value from Ricardo without very much critique. This form analysis only developed in slowly in the 50s and then in the 60s. And this had consequences for his notion of classes. When you read the first volume of Capital, the notion class or the word class appears, but in an extremely vague way. For example, in the fourth to sixth chapter, A Transformation of Money into Capital, Marx speaks of the class of money owners. This is not really a class notion. When you look to the table of content of Capital, you will find that Marx planned to write a chapter on classes. It should be the last chapter in volume 3. And when you now have in mind that the sequence in which Marx presented his issues has a theoretical significance, that when Marx presented something at the end, this means that everything what was said before is necessary to understand this. Then this means that, contrarily to the Communist Manifesto, Marx now had a notion of class which presupposes the whole theoretical development of the three volumes of Capital. It was not anymore a naive notion you just can start with. Unfortunately, he didn't write this chapter after one page. He interrupted it. He started to prepare the manuscript for volume 1 in order to publish it. But we can see something. The notion of class is not just a notion to say a member of a class, for example, a worker is someone who has to sell labor power, and a capitalist is someone who owns means of production. I think the notion of class has to be based on the whole reproduction process of capitalist reproduction. This is the theme of the of volume 3, the total process of capitalist reproduction. Only when we have this, we can speak in a useful way about classes and class composition. Working class, you can say the most general notion, of course, is the class of persons who need to sell labor power. And a capitalist class, a class who buys labor power with the aim to valorize capital. And now we look to reality. For example, we have a lot of independent, self-sustained entrepreneurs, but without that they have their own wage laborers. In many cases, I would say these self-entrepreneurs still belong to the working class. Only the legal framework has changed. Instead of having a labor contract which says 8 hours labor per day and a payment of, $500 per week, it is a contract. You have to deliver a certain service. Maybe the company even gives you the means of production. And when you have delivered, then you will receive a certain payment for the service, not payment for the labor power. By such constructions, for example, in Germany, where the wage labor is regulated, the employer has to pay for health insurance, for rent, and such new forms just make it easier for the capitalist. He can employ a person without all these social security payments. Basically, when we look to the total reproduction process, so I would say a lot of persons formerly not wage laborers still belong to the labor, to the working class. On the other hand, a lot of managers, formally employed by a company doing capital functions. No matter that formally they are wage laborers, I would say they don't belong to the working class, they belong to the capitalist class. To belong to the capitalist class, it is not necessary to own means of production or to own capital. The decisive point is what Marx already stresses in chapter 4, that you make the objective aim of capital, valorization, to the aim of your action. And insofar, okay, this would be my direction to look who belongs to the working class, to the capitalist class, to middle classes. Marx mostly uses the term middle class in the plural, middle classes, which already says it is a little bit more complicated. Okay, now the last question. You started with the critique of the Gotha program and labor certificates, which were mentioned there. And then you came to socialist planning, payment allocation, and asked what is the connection with time and value. I think in your remarks, they include several questions. It is not only one question. First, time and value. When we say labor time is the substance of value, it should be clear it is not concrete labor, which we can measure with a watch. When, for example, a certain carpenter produces in 5 hours a certain table, this 5 hours is concrete carpenter labor, and it is individual labor. I don't know if this carpenter was very quick or very slow with the 5 hours. So I don't know when the table is on the market, what does this 5 hours, which I can measure with a watch, really represents as value. As value counts only abstract labor, and abstract labor I cannot count with time, with the watch. The only, Marx makes a very nice remark already in 1859 in a contribution to the Critique of Political Economy, where he said that money is the immediate existence of abstract labor. So the only possibility to measure abstract labor is by money, but not by the watch. But because abstract labor has to do with concrete labor, we are talking about time, but it is not a time measurable with the clock. Nevertheless, for example, for wages, we use labor time. You have to work 8 hours in a company and receive a certain wage. When you do overtime, you work 2 hours more, then you receive overtime wages. In the Gotha program, Marx mentions these labor certificates, not because he really thinks in a socialist society we will have such certificates. He is doing this as an example to make clear the difference between value and non-value, that even when you try to distribute according to labor contributions, it is different from labor. The same he is doing in the first chapter of Capital, where he discusses very briefly societies not based on capitalism, on commodity production. And there he also speaks of the association of free persons, free producers, and they contribute to a common production, then they must have a rule how they distribute the product. And he said, let us say for an example, they distribute according to the labor time they worked. Again, it is just an example. It is not the idea to have such a kind of labor certificates in a socialist society. In so far, I don't think I can give a useful answer to this with the labor certificates. With the socialist planning you had in mind, it is, I suppose, socialist planning you could find in Soviet Union and economies influenced by the Soviet model. They did a planning of labor time, so many steel production we need, and it should be combined with so many other labor time. And there was also a payment mainly in accounting numbers. I think this has had absolutely nothing to do with value. There was a theory in textbooks, they spoke of the conscious application of the law of value. The idea was in a market economy, the law of value works unconsciously. And now we, with our socialist planning, try to make a conscious use of the law of value. And this was basically the attempt to find a kind of abstract measure. And this is, I would say, it is not possible. You have, when you have not a market, you only have a concrete measure. You can say, okay, maybe we have so many steel factories, so many workers, so many concrete hours of labor time, and under normal conditions, they will produce so many million tons of steel. Is this enough or is this not enough? When it is not enough, we need more steel factories or more workers. Can we get them? So you have to use concrete measurements of qualitatively different things. You have to negotiate. Can we do this or can we not do this? The attempt, what was done in the Soviet Union and also in Eastern Europe, it was a kind of simulation of markets. And this at the end led to a disaster. The planning numbers were pure illusions. The producers knew this. They tried to give wrong information to the planning central. The planning central knew that the producers give wrong information and they tried to correct. So at the end, the system was neither planning, neither market. It was just improvisation, going from one gap to another and try to hide this to show, oh, we are going from success to success. Every plan is not only fulfilled, it is overfilled. But the situation was rather disastrous in a lot of branches and respects. So all these attempts, I think, they just show how things will not work. But we cannot come with an analysis of value relations and use them for establishing non-value relation. These are different worlds which need different kind of analysis, different categories, different attempts. So when this was the last question, then okay, I can say as a hope, I hope that I will one day see this different world where we not anymore have to discuss about value and value form, but where we have to discuss about the social needs and how we can fulfill this in a way where labor processes are organized, that people can enjoy this, or at least will not be damaged by labor processes, and where we have a better life, but not anymore following such abstract notions, abstract aims like value and profit.
Well, thank you, Michael. I can't give you that different world, but I do hope we can show you another different world, which is Seattle when we do Red May Live and have these conversations go from bar to coffee shop to movie theater, as they do in our fabulous Marxathon, where we walked all day discussing Marx the way they do Ulysses in Dublin on Bloomsday. This was great. And obviously the conversation is continuing in our heads and could continue for hours longer. But I want to thank you on behalf of everybody who has worked to put together Red May for devoting your late hours in Berlin to our early hours in Seattle. And to just make the announcement that we have another event at 3 p.m. On the Red Deal, a new book from Red Media, from Malev. What's the name of your press? A senior moment. Okay, right. But anyway, we do have the Red
Deal. Common Notions.
Common Notions Press. I got them. Which is a great press that has a book, a selection of Mario Tronti's writings that came out last year. We did at Red May. So I guess here we're all going to eat lunch now with fond thoughts of this discussion. And give us some of your fond thoughts. Show us a little love, as Specter writes. We'll borrow that from our comrades at Specter and say, show a little love to Red May and go on our site and donate. We really need the money to keep, particularly to pay airfares next year. So thanks very much for coming. And thank you all for watching out there in the great land of YouTube.